Buenos dias. Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for the kind invitation to speak at your event. Sorry I can't be with you in person. I'd like to take a few moments this morning to talk a bit about uncertainty and how, as governments, we need to find better ways of navigating uncertainty and experimenting our way through to finding better policies that work for our citizens. And the skills and competencies that we need to develop within our public services to be equipped for this more uncertain future. But before we do, I'd like to start with a cautionary tale. Some of you may recognize this building, some of you may not. This is the headquarters of Eastman Kodak in Rochester, New York. Eastman Kodak, as you no doubt will be familiar, was one of the giants of the photography world, and at its height was the single largest seller of film for photography in the world. Founded in the 1880s, by the 1970s it was selling $3 billion worth of film every year. And yet, by 2012, Eastman Kodak went bankrupt, as first digital technology replaced film, and secondly, mobile phones replaced cameras. So you could say that Eastman Kodak is the poster child of how not to navigate uncertainty and disruption. If we think about the sorts of disruption that we are facing in our governments and societies around the world, as a result, particularly this year of COVID, we can see a similar scale of task ahead of us as we work out how best to respond. At one level, there is a level of uncertainty about what it is that we actually know. Typically, we tend to think about the things that we know for sure and for which we have validated knowledge, those things that we think we know but we can't be quite sure and are actually assumptions, and those things that are actually knowledge gaps, things that we don't know, or we know that we don't know. COVID has unsettled all of these. Our knowledge base has been upended about how best to respond in a policy way. Our assumptions about how different policies work are being challenged, and what the appropriate economic recovery strategies are, for example. And our knowledge gaps about everything from epidemiology to social behavior to international trade disruption is being challenged as a result of this crisis. So that's one level of uncertainty that we need to navigate. The second level of uncertainty is, how do we respond? So once we've developed a better understanding of the situation, we still need to work out how best to put in place as policies to respond to this new reality. Typically, we tend to use a fairly limited range of policy prescriptions that have been tested over many years or decades. Again, COVID has made the potential policy options, the template, if you like, the palette of options, much broader. And things that we would never have imagined implementing in non-emergency times have become now options that are being considered by governments around the world. This, on one hand, is quite liberating, but on the other hand, it can also be very disorienting, as a lot of these new policy ideas haven't actually been tested or used before or used for many, many decades. That said, we have been here before. Nearly 90 years ago, the world faced a global economic depression shortly after a global pandemic in the Spanish flu. And at the time, the leaders of the day, particularly Franklin Roosevelt, who came up with the New Deal, had this to say: the country needs, unless I mistake its temper, it demands bold experimentation. We should take a method and try it. If it fails, we should admit it frankly and try another. But above all, we have to try something. And I think this spirit speaks very much to the current time that we face at the moment. So we need bold, persistent experimentation. So how do we do this? And why do we do this? So we argue that experimentation is a systematic way of dealing with uncertainty. If you don't know, then try, test, and adapt. We see experimentation as sitting on a continuum from embracing uncertainty and asking yourself the question, what if? What if we tried this? What if this were true? Where the solutions are unknown. And as we start to develop hypotheses and tests and ideas that can be validated, we can start to develop a much more scientific validation mode. And as you can see under here, there are a number of different methods from experimental design through to randomized controlled trials that we can be using to help us to navigate that journey from the place where solutions are unknown to one where solutions are known. We also need to ensure that we explore just beyond those ideas which are close to hand. It's all very often when time is short, we tend to look where it's easiest. It's also known as the streetlight effect or the availability heuristic. But as a consequence, what ends up happening is we don't fully investigate all of the different ways that we might get to better public outcomes. And so we argue that you need to develop muscles to explore more broadly and more comprehensively than just the immediate solution set that maybe you've used time and time again. For those who are interested in innovation, Stephen Johnson makes the point that most innovation actually happens in the adjacent possible. That is, most innovation occurs when you find ideas from adjacent contexts and you bring them together to create a novel combination which generates better results. So often innovation is not in itself anything completely new, but rather it's an assemblage of different components from different areas, but brought together for the first time. And to find those components, you need to really develop your peripheral vision, your curiosity, and your imagination. So how do we go about exploring this space of the unobvious? We've developed a framework, a set of principles, if you like, for how you can unpack any particular policy challenge, and it consists of these six principles. And you can think of these as three distinct axes upon which to explore. So on the people systems axis, how do we drill right into understanding people's motivations, their beliefs and their values, and then zooming out to really look at the systems perspective and understanding where possible intervention points might be in that system. On the facts and futures axis, we should be looking at data and evidence historically to help us understand the nature of the challenge. But we should also project forward into the future, and using such techniques as horizon scanning, futures and foresights methodologies, and scenario planning, we can explore multiple possible futures and anticipate what solutions would work best for those futures. And then finally, the problems and systems, problems and solutions axis, which is about helping to frame and understand and identify the problem space before then identifying ideas and solutions that you can test. And doing that in an iterative way. So as you test the solution, that also informs how much you understand the nature of the problem. Another way of thinking about this is, how do we test our ideas at really small scale? Prototyping is how it's been, how it's called in the design world. How do we prototype solutions or policies at a really small scale so that we can find out what works before we've invested all of our resources? If we make mistakes, they're cheaper and they're quicker than if we were to wait till the very end of a large-scale implementation. And this, I think, challenges the notion often of how we do public policy and large-scale public sector implementation projects. So another way of thinking about experimentation is, it's a way of accelerating our learning. we've been working for many years to understand actually how to help build public sector teams that can do just this. And we developed a competency framework a few years ago at Nesta to really identify what are the skills and attitudes that public sector teams need to experiment and to solve public problems. And accelerating learning is one of the most critical. There are a range of new approaches and techniques from systems thinking to using data and digital technology, prototyping, which I've just mentioned, as well as understanding sort of futures methodologies, all of which help us to explore and test new ideas to come up with better solutions. But this isn't enough. We also need to develop better skills at working with others, working with other stakeholders, working with other citizens, at developing processes and facilitating processes to help people move through imagining what could be done differently. And then importantly, skills around how to lead change and make change real in the world. Everything from how you navigate politics and bureaucracy to how do you secure resources and support for your ideas, how do you tell effective stories and demonstrate the value of what you've come up with so that it's not just a good idea that sits in a corner gathering dust, but it actually becomes something that is real in the world and making a real impact for citizens. In addition to those skills, we saw a whole range of new attitudes that we feel are often undervalued, under-realized in the public sector. And we believe that these attitudes are really important for teams to have a good balance of, a mixture of being outcomes-focused, action-oriented, agile and resilient, with being imaginative, curious, reflective, empathetic. And it's in getting this balance between action and imagination that we can create space for thinking about how we can do things in a better way. We've used this tool with teams around the world for recruitment, for team development, for needs, for skills needs assessment, to understand what they need to work on to strengthen their ability to experiment and solve public problems. If you are interested in more on this, we have a publication, there are links here that you can dive into this a bit further. But we feel that these are the competencies for a 21st century public sector. I think if COVID has taught us anything, is that when the world, when our certainties about the way the world works have been shaken up so aggressively, that we need to have the ability to approach the problem using a fresh pair of eyes and a curiosity to reconfirm our understanding about what is the best policy response in this world. I might finish on with a quote to that point by a philosopher, Eric Hoffer, who said that in times of change, learners inherit the earth, while the learned find themselves beautifully equipped to deal with a world that no longer exists. And I think as we start to move through these next few years and the seismic impacts, economic, social, trade, environmental, from the pandemic and bigger crises like climate change, we are going to continue to need to have the candor to admit when our contexts have shifted, the humility to recognize that our often long-held knowledge and assumptions may no longer hold and need to be refreshed, and the courage to experiment our way through this uncertainty and out the other side. So I hope that that's given you a little bit of some food for thought as you think about what kind of public sector Costa Rica should be continuing to develop now and into the future. And I look forward to taking your questions. Thank you very much.